Not Your Mama's Momentum, How to Profit by Going Beyond Overbought, Oversold. And what this is about is that I'm going to teach you how to amplify the power of an indicator that's pretty much in every trading system out there. And it's really actually very underused. So you're going to walk away with knowledge that you can use to study the markets, improve your trading right away, again, using this very commonly referenced indicator. And before we do that, we got to get the homework out of the way where I tell you about all the risks of trading and how important it is that you take everything I'm showing you and you evaluate the information, opinion, advice, or other content contained in my presentation. Okay. Now, if at any point you guys don't hear me well, although I think with my fabulous new microphone, I've got a Blue brand Yeti. Anybody who knows USB mics knows this is a pretty much of a beast of a microphone, but it's awesome. And it's been making good quality for me recently. But if you can't hear me, please shout. I have one eyeball on the question box and one eyeball on my slides. So with that, as Jeanette said, I'm Hima Reddy. I've been studying financial markets for over 15 years now. And I was actually first introduced to them by my late father. He was a doctor by day, but he traded very, very actively. And he traded commodities, stocks, index futures in his retirement accounts and regular trading accounts as well. So I was super inspired by what I learned from him about using math and probability to make money trading in markets and decided to go study finance at Indiana University. And in all my 4 years there, you know, I studied hard, I graduated on time. But when it came to learning about this kind of stuff, you know, charts and trends and candlesticks, I just didn't see any of it. And I came to my dad and to his frustration, having not applied for a single job out in the iBanking world, said, I want to do this stuff, Dad. I want to do what I saw at your desk when I was 16 years old. So he's like, all right, I'll let you move home. You work part time and I'll teach you. That was the arrangement. So I moved back home to Long Island, New York, and my father handed me this book. He literally had to dust it off his shelf, and it was called How to Make Profits Trading in Commodities. Now, this was written by somebody named W.D. Gann. How many of you in here have heard of Gann? Just give me a G or a Gann in the room if you've heard of Gann. Because actually, Gann wrote about the markets. Okay, wow, we've got quite a few folks. So Gann was well-versed and experienced trader and writer of trading education books back in the early 1900s. So based on his photo and based on the title cover of this book, you can imagine how excited I was to read this at the age of 22. But my dad said this is what I had to do, so I went ahead and did it. Now, the fun part was that he set me up with a TradeStation simulated account at first and then eventually funded it for me so I could actually trade and learn. But he said TradeStation was the best. And I didn't know any better, so I trusted him. And I'll say 15 years later, I still feel that TradeStation is pretty awesome and made a lot of advances. Now, he told me to set up the chart you see here, all right? It is a bar chart, and it's one-minute bars of the E-mini S&P 500 futures. I don't know if anybody in here knows how old it's not that old. I believe it launched in 1997, and I started getting to the markets in early 2000s. So it's like taking his young child and throwing me into the lion's den. It was very, very volatile, still is. But he said to watch this for 3 hours a day, every day for a whole month. Until then, he wouldn't talk to me about it. He wouldn't go through the book with me. He just said to do this first. So I was like, all right. So I would read the book, watch the market, take turns doing both. Now, the crazy thing was just like a week or two in, I started to see buy and sell signals on this 1 minute bar chart form in the way that Gann described them in his book. And I thought, well, that's pretty interesting. So of course, my first question to him was, you know, do markets act similarly, even if you're looking at different timeframes? He was like, yes, that's the beauty of it all. And he encouraged me to keep studying the E-mini and keep studying the examples in Gann's book. Now, Gann's book, while very, very dense and high value content is in there, it is not designed as a teaching with images kind of book. And I do well by learning with images and colors and stuff. So I went on and took what I was reading, drew all by hand first on paper, then translated my sketches into graphic images like these. And I started collecting them and printing them out like index card size and laying them all over the wall near my desk. And this helped me to get a full grip on what Gann signals were and help me identify them in the market as I would see them. So What I also did was, after a couple months, I got more comfortable with my understanding of price floors or support and price ceilings or resistance. And I started to kind of get an idea at the close each day of where I think things might be the next morning. I was analyzing and I didn't even realize it. So I started sending emails like the one you see here to my dad. You can see the date, July 6, 2005. So I'm not joking when I said I've been doing this for a long time. And I called these reports the skinny on the mini, because to me, well, it made sense. It was the lowdown. It was the true essence, the basic points. And you know, that's the skinny is slang for that. So I'd send these reports out, and then I actually got really busy studying for something called a CMT. Now, the CMT, actually, if you go Google this term, could be crew mission time. Anybody out in Coast Guard or Navy history or Navy background might know that. It can be children's music theater. I was actually very involved with a children's museum when we lived in Baltimore, my husband and I. So this is a term I actually used, but the original CMT that I'm talking about, which is the one that I've got, is called Chartered Market Technician Designation, okay? So I learned that this would be my ticket to getting a job as professional technical analyst, and that was my end goal. So I got really busy studying for my exams and trading a lot less, but it's still right the skinny on the mini, and I would send it to my dad. And then something really crazy happened after a few weeks when he was incorporating this into his trading, but not telling me about it. I just thought he was reading them and kind of checking it like homework. He actually started making winning trades using a lot of the stuff I would talk about, timing points, my levels, my anticipation of trend reversals. So you can imagine we were both pretty happy, and I knew I was kind of maybe onto something. Now, after completing my CMT exams, it took 3 years, I went on to work as an analyst at an independent research firm in New York. And then I got the chance in 2010 to write my own introductory level book, focusing on GAN's works. Those little images I showed you guys that I had digitized were part of what became my book. And my book pictured here, The Trading Methodologies of W.D. GAN, published in 2012, October. So I had this book. I had transitioned out of my analyst job after meeting my husband, who became my fiance, and I moved to Pittsburgh where he was training. And I decided to go ahead and bring back the skinny on the mini and start sending it not only to my dad, but my book readers, my webinar and lecture attendees, like you guys here, and my colleagues from the CMT Association who were using technicals day in and day out. Now, after a couple years, my husband and I actually then moved to Minnesota. Now, he, pictured here, is from Wisconsin. I am an East Coast girl, so I really didn't know where these states were until I had to live there. Be honest with you, which is why I'm showing you here. But one of my husband's great achievements among his surgery career is completely outside of that. It's inserting me into a t-shirt wearing and bratwurst eating Green Bay Packers football fan. He is born and raised 20 minutes outside of Green Bay. So that was my destiny from the moment I started dating him. But the important thing here is that when he started working in Minnesota, so did I, at an equity at the equity research section of Piper Jaffray, an investment bank. You can imagine, you're working in an investment bank, you can't do any of your own research, so I had to stop sending out the skinny. So I went back to all these folks who had grown in size, and I told them I had to stop sending this out, at least for a while. And they were so sad, and they started telling me, remember, I was sending out for free, they started telling me how they were making money off it too. So I just knew in the back of my head, I've got to bring this back someday. Now, we are currently in Buffalo, New York. And after coming to Buffalo and transitioning out of my sell side job, I've decided this is the time. This is when I need to bring back the skinny for good. And I came back to my subscribers and I offered them this newsletter for a monthly subscription fee, and they started paying for it. The important part of this story is that people were getting something for free. Then when you asked them for money for it, they started paying for it because it was that valuable to them. And then they pushed beyond. They said, Hima, we don't just want your skinny. We want to learn how you're conducting this analysis so that we can do it on our own markets. And this whole story leads me to today as part of the TradeThirsty team. All right. Now, we're going to get into the concept that I would like to make sure you understand the base elements first. And then, like I said, I'm going to actually teach you something that you can run off and use on your own as soon as we're done here. Although you really should stick around for John and make sure you stick around for the trading competition. Okay. So in order to convey this very, very important point, let's take a look at a little family of rubber duckies, okay? These ducks represent some important parts of our market approach. The first guy, or I guess the last little guy in the lineup, is news, right? We all ingest TV, radio, emails, right? And this is important in knowing about economic reports, political events, etc. Then we usually move on to our analysis. You might get reports like the skinny and the mini, or you might be in a trading room and your mentor in the trading room might tell you about some charts to look at, or you might just be doing all this on your own. Again, super important part of the process. After you've gotten your news and analysis fill, you then probably go to your blank chart and maybe throw an indicator onto it. And that can be very, very helpful. You know, looking at things like volume and sentiment and all of that can add a lot of value to what you're already getting out of the charts. But notice that these are the little ducks, okay? And the little ducks, just like in the real world, the little ducks follow the mama, because the mama takes them to food and to shelter and to the nearest body of water. So what's the mama for us in markets? Well, in my view, to follow the mama is to follow momentum, okay? Mama, mom, get it? And to follow momentum is to follow price. That is not my view. That is a fact. Momentum is purely a different aspect of price movement, but I think that remembering it this way and this little mama image will remind you when you're throwing all those indicators on your chart that momentum is super important to include in the mix. Now, I went to college at Indiana, I told you, and the Indy 500, as many of you might know, is a popular car race. And so I thought I'd use this analogy because I had a lot of friends who worked the Indy 500, you know, in catering or other jobs during the summer each year. Let's take the analogy of this racetrack and the car race and use that to make sure we all understand how momentum works, okay? So we first start at the starting line, just like any other race would. You rev up your engine and you get going. You paid really quickly. And on this first run, you got to accelerate, right? If you're trying to win this thing. Then suddenly you approach a turn and you realize, hey, unless I want to fly off and go into the bleachers, I better let off the gas a tiny bit. So you don't slow down on purpose, but you definitely stop going as fast as you were, even if it's just for a few milliseconds. Then you come around the stretch and you're on the next path of the track. And so you pick up your speed again and you keep going. Okay, give me a car or Indy in the room if you guys understand driving a race car on the track. Because this concept is totally tied to how momentum works. Okay, car, Indy, whatever car word you want to throw in there, but I need to see it to make sure you guys are following along, because I know I've been telling a little. Okay, great. Thank you. So taking this idea of the changes in speed on the racetrack, right? Let's just take the racetrack itself, and now we're like in that helicopter that I first showed you, and we're looking down, okay? So we're looking down at the racetrack, and we're going to equate price to the racetrack, and momentum is going to be underneath. So let's walk through this. Pretend this racetrack is price action. So when prices are rising or in an uptrend, right, a series of higher highs, higher lows, you generally have rising momentum. There is more force going into that move. The thing is, momentum generally, okay, none of this is 100% all the time, but most of the time, a peak in momentum leads a peak in price. All right, that's interesting. Sometimes an uptrend is immediately followed by a downtrend. It could be consolidation, but let's keep things simple and say we're changing from an uptrend to a downtrend. Lower lows, lower highs, falling prices. Well, momentum is generally falling in this situation as well, but it's usually doing so at a pretty steady clip. Then, just like we saw on the topping action, when a market's bottoming, the momentum trough or low generally leads the price trough or low. So when you think about momentum, what it does for you is it gives you a heads up. I think of all momentum indicators as this heads up indicator because they're supposed to peak before and after price does. And if you can catch that, then you can kind of get ready for that reversal move or at least that pause in the current trend and act upon it. Now, here's a pop quiz, very important one. What team did I say my husband is a huge fan of and that he's converted me to love as well? I mean, obviously we're talking about football here. Yes, the Packers. I recognize some of you guys in this room. You've heard me talk about this before, but here's another question. Into Thursday night, what team was it that between the Packers and this team, they had a completely tied history, same number of wins, about six ties, and this was their 195th game? Oh, it's not the Steelers. It was the Bears. So anybody who's watched football, that was easy enough to answer. But as you might imagine, my husband was very excited for this. I stayed up about halfway through, and then I just was tired. But the first thing I asked him in the morning before I opened my eyes, did the Packers win? Yes, they obliterated the Bears. Very happy week in the Reddy household. So we've got the Packers in the green and gold. We've got the Bears. These are the best stock images I could find, but I think they do the job. Now, is there anybody in this room who doesn't know how football works? Because I want to make sure you understand why I'm talking about this related to momentum. Just type in soccer if that's what football is to you. Now, it seems like we've got most folks understanding in here. Okay. So, no sports even? Okay. So let's make sure we get the basics here. So you see a ball in the middle of the field, all right, and you've got each team on each side. The important thing to know is that whether you're starting at like the 20, these are yards, okay? So the 20-yard line, which a yard is 3 feet, anybody who is not here in the U.S. and not using inches, this 20-yard line or this 40-yard line, it doesn't matter where you're starting, but each team lines up on the side of that. And the point of football is a lot like soccer, what the rest of the world calls football, is you don't get any points in the middle of the field. You've got to get to your end zone. So the Packers have to make their way through the Bears, like physically through them, past them, over them, into the end zone to score points. And the Bears, if it's their turn with the ball, they have to do the same thing. They have to get past the Packers and get to the end zone. Okay? You don't score points in the middle of the field. That's the key takeaway from this. So let's take that football field and let's just flip it on its head. Okay? And then we're going to shrink it down, and then we're going to bring it onto a price chart. And here we have a momentum indicator on the bottom. This is the relative strength index. If you're familiar with the RSI, just give me an RSI in the room, because some folks might be brand new to this, so I want to make sure you get the important concept. Okay, you all know, lots of you know the RSI. Okay, great. But I bet that you haven't looked at it the way I'm going to show you, at least not with the visual representation that I'll give you. So let's go through some basics. The standard setting is 14 periods. So if you're in a daily chart like we're here, we're with my baby, the E-mini S&P 500 daily chart, about a year of price action. Every set data point of the RSI is based on the past 14 days. If this was an hourly chart, it would be the past 14 hours, etc. Okay. Now, you see these two lines. The upper green line is 70. The lower green line we'll get to in a second, but the upper green line is 70. And the RSI only moves between 0 and 100. Okay, so you don't have to worry about 265 or something. You're stick to 0 and 100. The sell signals generally are considered to live above 70, where if the RSI moves above 70 and turns lower, it turns red. This is what my TradeStation default RSI indicator does. So you can see here that that might be a little misleading or get you caught up in a lot of chop if there's a strongly trending market, as you see here. This ES, ever since Election Day back in November, has been pretty steadily higher. The other side of this is the 30 oversold level, and buy signals generally live down here, okay? So you're looking to see changes from oversold to neutral or overbought back to neutral. Now, the other general consensus, and this is the way I learned about the RSI during my CMT studies, is that momentum oscillators, including the RSI, are generally only useful during trading ranges. They help you get in near the top of a trading range and, you know, buy at the top, bottom of a trading range. So I don't know about you guys, but when I look at this ES chart, I see an uptrend for the most part. So if that was the approach, it would mean, hey, nothing to see here, folks, okay? But this is just not going to help us in an uptrend or downtrend, but that's not true. The last little bit here of why this approach limits you, say it's not bad. Mr. Wells Wilder created something extremely useful, but this approach and the way it's taught traditionally, and I would know because all my technical analysis education has been mostly traditional, is one thing I started to notice on my own is that signals could be really short-lived. You might get to 70, whip back down from that overbought level, But then you're getting ready to sell, and then the thing is just pulling back a little bit before it resumes higher. So all of the point of this is that when it comes to using the only the standard approaches to overbought and oversold, we're calling BS, okay? Drop those O's, call BS. Again, no offense to Mr. Wilder, but based on something that I learned from my CMT studies, which was an extrapolation from this, there are actually these zones that come into play that use a lot more of what's going on between the zero and 100, okay? I did not invent this approach that I'm showing you, but I learned about it, and then it totally like was incorporated into my trading analysis approach, and I developed a lot of things from there, as you'll see. So let's go back to football, last time, I promise. Remember the Bears, okay? The team, the Chicago Bears, they've got to get past the Packers and get to their zone to score points. So in the same way, the market bears have to push down further in this RSI 0 to 100 range to make anything happen. It's supposed to be the case that if prices are trending lower, they get more oversold before anything interesting happens in terms of turning around. So we're going to call these power zones, because that's just what I've felt that they've become, is super powerful zones of support and resistance. So the bear resistance power zone, and this is a good time to write down the numbers or put them on a scratch pad or your computer, is 55 to 65, not 70, okay? So we're saying that if there's a downtrending market, which we don't have here, but you'll see examples, that it's generally going to find resistance on the RSI between 55 to 65. And it's going to fall to 20 to 30, not just the traditional 30 and whip back up, but that you want to look at that whole area from 30 to 20 as the support for a bear market or a downtrend, okay? The market bulls, okay, they get things more overbought. So they have a bull resistance power zone of 80 to 90. They push the market higher into what you see here, that green shaded area. So that's 80 to 90 is the bull resistance power zone. And the bull support power zone is 40 to 50. Okay, we're going to go through these numbers again if you missed them. But this is taking apart the traditional approach to the RSI and looking at it with a lot more, I guess, nuance. Remember, though, we are not messing with the 14-period setting. I don't care if you're on a three-minute chart or a quarterly chart or a weekly chart. That stays 14. If you change the 14, this does not work. So let's go into an example. And what I do with my chart example, as you can see here, there is a full chart underneath this. But I like to unfold the price action as I go to make sure you guys can follow along, okay? And I have yellow highlights that mark everything. This way, you don't have to watch for my mouse cursor wiggling around. I might do that here and there, but I set this up by design to kind of teach you as it's going, and that way we also don't have other things distracting us, and we don't have the value of hindsight where it's easy to look back and say, oh yeah, well that held there. Let's just pretend that this market's unfolding as we watch it. So this is an actual chart from one of my recent Skinny in the Mini reports. I specifically took one from August because we only rolled to the December contract on September 8th, and today's September 30th. And when I look at the recent price action, honestly, there just weren't that many great examples for me to show you all the signals I wanted. So this August 30th chart still provides a great number of signals as examples and was the actual contract being traded at the time. Notice ESU17, right? U stands for September, so this was the front month at the time. So let's bring our attention first to the zones. This is your last chance to write them out with my descriptions, but you're going to see the numbers over and over, okay? So make sure you got them. RSI bear support zone is the bottom two red lines. Okay, this is what I did was I was, again, I learned about this when I was studying, but I couldn't find the visual for it in the way I saw it in my head, which is green to green is the bull zone and red to red is the bear zone. So for years, I would just draw lines over the indicator over and over until I got more familiar with programming, easy language, et cetera. And then I created this for the RSI. And when I handed it to the programmer, he named it RSI Hima and gave it back to me. So I just kept that name and also have it for other systems. But the bear support zone is 20 to 30. The next two lines, the green ones, are the bull support zone at 40 to 50. We've got the red lines that are towards the top that are 55 to 65. And then the very last set of lines all the way to the top is the bull resistance zone 80 to 90. Okay. You're going to see these repeated, but again, it's just these numbers and then watching how price action moves through them. That's the first phase of what we're looking at here. So we had some price action unfold in ES, right? It fell down from this high that has this purple circle on it, fell down, rallied. And this corrective rally up to the top coincided with the RSI holding at 55 to 65, which is the bear resistance power zone. So that was a clue that this downtrend action may persist. As you can see, it did very, very nicely. And you had a very sharp move lower and kept going. And then we had the RSI come down to the 20 to 30 range. It actually fell lower than that. Okay, I'm not at all saying that the RSI now becomes limited to 20 on the downside and 90 on the upside. What I'm saying is that monitoring these ranges relative to the price action will better keep you with the trend, or if you're looking for trend reversal signals, will highlight them more clearly. And we'll see more of that as we go here. Okay, so 20 to 30, I mean, we came further down than 20, right? But then rallied back. So this zone is as oversold as things got really oversold, okay? Now, by this time, something funny happens. Lower low in price, higher low in the RSI. Well, that's kind of interesting, right? Well, this is the first signal on the RSI to teach. So this is the situation here, a lower low in price and a higher low in the RSI. This is called a bullish divergence. Okay, divergence just means two things pulling away from each other. So price and momentum are pulling away from each other. And remember, we said that RSI or momentum is a heads up, right? So this is giving you a heads up that, hey, the RSI is actually improving, even though price is still falling apart. Maybe it means that the downside momentum is running out and we're getting ready for a turn. It's not 100%, but it can be very, very reliable the more you observe it and the more you qualify it. And I'm going to teach you how to qualify it. So here we have, oh, sorry. So as you can see from the bullish divergence that occurred here, okay, so we were like, let's say at 2430 roughly was the lows, right? So I taught you the divergence and you can see afterwards that from there we blasted higher up to 2470 or so. Okay, guys, type a 2470 in the room for me if I know you're following along. I know it's Saturday morning, possibly. Some of you might be even more west than me, but I want to make sure I've got you following. Okay, super, thank you. So we rallied and look at where the RSI went. It came up close to the 80 to 90 area. It didn't go to 70 and then just everything stopped. Okay, that's what I'm trying to make the point of here. Now, after that, we fell, and what do you know? Support held at 40 to 50, okay? Then rallied again. Now, here we have a higher high in price and a lower high in the RSI. Again, kind of a funny looking thing, and as you might imagine, this presents the opposite scenario to what I just showed you with the divergences. So let's go to the former part of this chart where we've got an illustration of a higher high in price and a lower high in the RSI. This is a bearish divergence. This is a sign that upward momentum is slowing down. Price does not have a lot of steam behind it, basically, and likely to top out or at least pause. It's not always a matter of switching from uptrend to downtrend. If the market worked that way, I'd be very happy. But it would be very unlikely that you're trading any market that just constantly goes from up to down. So these can call for a pause, okay? I have a question here. Do you use this irrespective of bull or bear market? Well, the point here that is I'm trying to illustrate is first to make you understand movement through the zones. And if you, we'll get to that in a second, is the placement of the divergence versus the zone. And that'll help answer your question about that. So here we've got a bear divergence in the bear resistance power zone. Okay, so these are things you can write down, guys. These are little takeaways. So you already know the bear resistance power zone is 55 to 65. You now learned what a bear divergence is. It doesn't matter what market, what time frame, but the general approach would be this. Again, this is a counter trend move. You're calling for a reversal, so you have to be careful. But this is a situation where watching for a sell entry setup on price, whatever your signals are or whatever your other indicators are telling you, will likely be amplified and strengthened as a sell signal if you see the bearish divergence occur in the bear resistance zone. Now, in is, you know, we could get very technical in terms or very specific around that, but I think we can all agree that what you see going on here between 55 and 65 is the bear resistance zone holding. If you're looking for something super exact and that it never goes above 65 or never falls below 20, then you're going to miss a lot of signals, but you can filter it that way. Okay. Some of this is me eyeballing after using this for years and years and years. Okay. So this is one setup. Now, in this situation, you had a variety of things that you could have been using. Maybe it was candles. Maybe you had other resistance levels. Maybe you had shorter term signals telling you that it was time to sell. And you can see how nasty the fall was and how oversold the RSI got, guys. Look, it fell really far. So I want you to get out of this habit of, oh, RSI is below 30. I better start buying things up. You've got to be careful of that, because that will get you usually caught up on the wrong side of a trade. And then by the time you've given up and decide, oh, I got long too early and get out, guess what? That's usually when the market does bottom and rises back up, okay? Does this work with Renko or tick charts? To be honest, I'm not sure about Renko, but I'll tell you right now, I would not use this for tick charts. Why? Because tick charts, by definition, are based on movement. They don't have a consistent time interval, right? And the relationship here between price and momentum is what you want to make sure is staying steady. So I would only use this on charts that have an actual time frame, like a 60-minute chart or a 3-minute chart or a daily or weekly. With tick charts, you should experiment. That being said, let's say you use this 60-minute chart and you see this signal. If you're trading a tick chart, like the question asked here by, who is it here? By, well, Trader M. So I assume your first name starts with M. Then you can actually go through to down to your tick chart and see if you have a signal to sell as well that's reinforced by the higher time frame. Okay. So let's keep it moving, guys, because I want to make sure we get to John on time. So we already did this. Now we fell out of bed and you can see a very severe what? We have a lower low in price and a higher low in the RSI. Quiz time. What is this? It's one of those two signals I just taught you. Lower low in price, higher low in the RSI. Awesome, William. Thank you. Bullish divergence. So here's something else to write down. When you have a bullish divergence, but it's in the bear support zone, okay, think about that. You're getting a bullish signal, but it's in a situation where the market's been so oversold. You need to be careful with that. So here's the guidance for that. You can either do A or B, the first or second bullet. Exit your shorts just to protect your profit if you've been short from up above, or tighten up on stops and short positions. It's aggressive to enter long. What does aggressive mean? Well, that requires a lot more scope, but aggressive enter long. This is something I actually taught to folks who attended the Super Trader Summit last week. I gave them an exact specific entry strategy, an exact specific stop, and what aggressive is versus anything else. But for now, you guys can still take this guidance and run with it and say, okay, I see a bullish divergence, ooh, but it's happening in the bear support zone. This is a little bit dangerous. So it looks beautiful, right? It looks like we're going to blast higher and have great gains, but look what happened. The ES fell out of bed again. It posted yet another divergence. So my dad used to call these a triple divergence, but I guess technically it's like a double divergence because we've got two higher lows. Either way, now we have another setup. Bull divergence in the bull support power zone. Okay, you see how we're basically comparing a bull or bear divergence relative to the four zones. Now, when you have a bull divergence in the bull support power zone, this is acted upon and this in the same way as a bear divergence in the bear resistance zone, where now you can actually watch for a buy setup. Okay. Obviously in the bear scenario, you'd watch for a sell setup, but this is much more likely to fall in line with a new trend higher and produce gains instead of chopping you out if it was happening in the bear support zone. In this situation, blast off. okay, from the 40 to 50 support zone on that third low, futures rallied higher. I didn't even highlight this, but look here again, they held, you see my mouse moving back and forth. They held the 40 to 50, rallied higher again, stopped at the 80, didn't at least, didn't necessarily stop. So we're going to move out of this ES signal to other markets. But again, I want to, the question about ticks sort of helped answer this FAQ that I get on what types of charts and time frames can use RSI power zones. Any active market on any time frame. Time frame is the important part, guys. Time frames, okay? Not ticks, because with a tick chart, again, you're plotting movement as it's happening. The tick only plots and moves when it changes. So you could be 5 minutes apart, you could be 1 minute apart. I would advise heavy testing of that before you use it. 14 periods, any time frame, any active market. All right, now that being said, let's go to a FANG stock, all right? So let's go to Google. Now I did this fresh new yesterday. You'll see this price action is right through the close yesterday. And I want to just kind of walk you through how Google, which has obviously been rallying for the past almost eight years shown here, 10 years almost shown here, has respected the bull and bear ranges. And then this blue line, you can ignore for now, but I'm going to show you what I measure, how I measure upside targets and how that fell in line with the zone action, okay? So clearly, back in mid-2012, we had this beginning of a breakout. And you can see that not only did the RSI hold at 40 to 50 on the weekly chart, guys, so you can use this again on any time frame, okay? Then this rallied through the previous high. Notice that this making headway through the bull bear resistance zone and coming off the bull support zone was probably a good sign that this market might be picking up. Now, it didn't have a huge, massive rally for a weekly chart. It was good size, but look how momentum got to 80 to 90, then everything paused. After it paused, it came back to the bull support zone, rallied again, and this was a little bit more of a choppy advance, again on a weekly chart, but here you have a situation again, 40 to 50 held support. Again, we can write down this signal that you can go and apply and incorporate into your method. Best test it first on your own. Bullish divergence in the bull support power zone. Watch for a buy entry setup on price. Now, this setup you see here, I'm going to walk you through what I actually calculated. So if you care about Google, you watch Google, you'll have numbers to jot down. Or you can take a photo with your phone, I guess, or screenshot. These are GAN 8's projections. So a funny thing happened at the Super Trader Summit. I was using Hubert Center's computer to do my presentation because my beautiful little Aces ZenBook didn't have the HDMI. I needed a big HDMI connection. So he was setting me up on his trade station so that I could do some charts walkthrough, and he's asked me, do you use Fibonacci or Elliott Wave? And my answer was neither. And he looked at me like I had six heads. So the reason was because I used GAN 8s. What GAN did, the reason behind it, you can speculate, but instead of using Fibonacci numbers, of course he was likely aware of them. They had existed for a long time. He just divided ranges into eights, right? That's easy. You cut into once, you cut one more time, and then you cut one last time, and you got eights. So in 61.8% like Fibonacci, 62.5% is again eights level. And you're going to see these unfold. But what I measured here on the Google weekly chart was the low, which is highlighted in blue here, from November 2008 at $123.65, okay, I ran my Fibonacci tool on TradeStation, but again, I just changed the inside numbers. Ran that tool up to the high from February 2014 at $614.44, and then projected that from the following low that formed, which was at $490.91 in January 2016. Okay, I'm going to pause here for a second and get water. I highly recommend. I'll have these numbers up, but you may want to take a photo or something of this if you're trying to follow me on these projections. But you'll see as they unfold and what the zones did and how that might have been helpful. Okay. So let's look at the first projection. Now, there were others along the way, right? You could have, they start at 12.5%. That's 1/8. 25% is 2/8. 37.5% is 3/8. 4/8 is 50%, but let's look at 5/8. 5/8 is 62.5%. I made this a gray dashed line because we're unfolding price action that already happened. Okay, that level is not valid anymore in the current trading, but I'm showing you this market as if it's unfolding now. These three blue vertical lines show the three instances on a weekly chart where price hit that projection, which was $797.12, and then backed off. Now, you might get excited to sell big time on Google and, you know, for investing long-term trade. Well, in the short term, you may have had some sell opportunities those weeks, but look at what the RSI did. All it did was work itself off. It did have a bearish divergence there. But when you look at the bigger picture trend, this is clearly up. You need to be careful when you're counter trend. You pull this down and you see all it did was come back into the 40 and 50 range. See? So when you hit projected resistance and pull back down, if you're in a strong uptrending market, then all you're going to do likely is just unwind and then find new support at 40 to 50. Moving on, we kept trading up through the 62.5%, and got to the 75% projection. Oh, this one stopped in the bear resistance zone. Oh, time to sell, time short Google, call the multi-year high. No. It was just a pause, guys. Okay. When you're trading short term, when you're trading and holding your trades for, I don't know, a few days, a few weeks or something, these long-term levels help because it lets you get out, whether you want to get out because that's just your rules or you want to get out because you're going on summer vacation. But look at how this continued on. Every time we hit a target, they were useful. Okay, the market actually got there, paused there with enough time to take advantage of that. But I want to make the point that when a market is strongly trending, you won't always see resistance coincide with a full return back to the zone or a full unwinding of momentum. Sometimes it's just a brief pause. And look at the most recent ones, okay? I think this, yeah, that's the end of the chart. This is where we closed yesterday, is that last big green bar. These two instances, couple months apart, where the blue highlights are, show reaching the 100% projection of the move. So this 100% projected price, $980.85, that could have been calculated back in 2016, when we met it, the market formed essentially a weekly double top there. And then all it did during all of that time, the past couple months, was unwind on the weekly chart from the bull resistance zone 80 to 90 to the bull support zone 40 to 50. Okay? I hope you guys are getting this idea now, and we're going to keep it moving because we've got Tony on in 50, Peter, John. Oh my God, I don't know where my brain is going. John, right? John Netto. I'm sorry, John. In 15 minutes, and I want to make sure I finish things out with you. So we're going to move a little faster here. Oil. Lots of people talk about oil. Here's my one hint about oil that is a follow-up to the video that TradeThirsty sent out of mine on September 20th, calling some more upside in oil. I will tell you that I see potential for oil to get to $55. But notice the oil continuous daily chart. Look how it's respected the bear zones. Okay, this is through yesterday. So this is very, very heavy resistance zone coming in oil, even with the change each month to the new front month. But look lately, it's been holding the bull support zone. That's the lower of the two yellow highlights. That was the clue that got me thinking that maybe oil is trying to recover a bit. I'm not saying it gets above $60 anytime soon. $55 upside target for oil. And I can get more specific on that maybe in an update video. We'll see. But here's one more concept I want to make about how this tool can work and this approach to momentum can work even when there's like weird events, unexpected market activity. Let's just take elections, okay? I know that between last November and now, there's a lot of other stuff like North Korea, every time it talks, every time Trump talks back. But let's just stick to the elections, the big elections in Europe and the US. So we can all see that election day in November was this nasty spiky bar on the NASDAQ futures, okay, NQ. Well, from there, we can also see that the market rallied after it held in the bull support zone, mind you, 40 to 50, right? Those are the two lower green lines, rallied, stopped at 80 to 90. France election came in. There was a little tenuous there, you know, between who's going to win and how that might impact things. A lot of drama, A lot of dramatic price action those two, three sessions. But look, within 3 days, we went on the daily chart from the 80 to 90 bull resistance zone down to the bull support zone from 40 to 50. Okay, this election didn't make this thing just suddenly not work anymore. Same thing with the Britain election. A couple months later, or a month later, you had this movement down, these two long bars, but they had long lower shadows if you look at candles, and held support at 40 to 50. Now, I'm going to finish off with an intraday look at this and an actual, like, real life trade person could have made with timestamps, okay? So what I did was I was doing this trade and capturing it with screenshots, which is a lot of work, which is like not something I'm going to do all the time, to make the point about how this works intraday. 3 minute chart for the E-mini is my preferred trading time frame. This was Thursday, September 7th. And this is the Z chart, okay? So this is right after rollover, which a lot of people might wait till Friday because they want more volume, but I went ahead and just switched based on the rollover date. 9:36 a.m. Eastern, okay? 6 minutes after the market opens. Oh, I see. What do you guys see here? Lower, low on the RSI, high on price. Give me the answer, please. All right, bear divergence. William again. He's my participation star student of the day. Okay. Bearish divergence in the bear resistance power zone. Well, what you do with that is you can find a sell setup, right? I already told you guys that. So here, a couple minutes later, 9:51 a.m., the lower price high was holding and RSI was still weakening. So here's a setup. Sell at market because it's a 3 minute chart. If this was a daily chart or higher, I would recommend selling at the close of the signal bar. But in this situation, you sell at market. So that would be the close of the previous bar, basically. So you get filled short pretty instantly on the next bar, okay, 3 minutes later. Now, here's where your protective stop goes. And this is based on some more specifics about a course I'm working on. It's not ready yet. On the specific entry stops exits for intraday trading using the power zones. But just keep in mind, just for example's sake, this is where your stop goes, and this is where your next target would be based on what I see going on with the technical analysis and the price floors ahead. I think 2-to-1 is good enough on a 3 minute chart. If you're going trading daily higher timeframes, you probably want 3-to-1 on your 2-to-1 is pretty good here. You get filled short, and then it was very quick to see that this order was filled and it worked. And look at the RSI, guys. Look at it weakening well beyond 30, okay? You've already got your limit exit buy order. You had your stop. Now you take that stop down and you trail it. Trail it to break even. Trail it to either the exact tick that you got short at, if you can live with your commission cost being technically a loss, or trade it to a tick below where you enter so that you're clear. I mean, unless you're using some crazy expensive platform. But I know in TradeStation that if I move it to a tick below, I'm good. Basically, it would lock in a couple of bucks, all right? So you trail down your protective buy stop. So now you're in a trade that you're going to like win no matter what. Either you're going to get to your limit buy exit order, and the RSI is still telling you that this might happen. Or, you know, even if there's a crazy spike up, there's a decent chance you can get out near break even. But in this situation, the downside target was met. And look, see, by anticipating support, again, based on other factors, you're able to just get out and not think about it again. And then there was more of a rally and stuff in this. So these are the examples I have for you guys. I hope this showed you a way to look at momentum that you really can take and do and look at on your own charts. Now, you're probably wondering, all right, this is great, but this was like a really quick, you know, 45 minutes or so. How do I learn more? Well, what I'll give you is the opportunity to actually see these zones on your charts, again, using the 40 period RSI, and get examples of RSI power zones in action every day for a month. How do you do this? Well, first, let's walk through what these examples would look like, okay? So they would be on my skinny and the mini, and whether you trade the ES or not, the ES chart that I publish every single trading day always has that power zones on it. Just always does, whether I highlight what's going on in them or not. So here's what my ES report looks like, because report newsletter sounds like very cumbersome. It's not. There's a chart, there's a description, okay? description tells you exactly when I snapped this chart, and then I generally publish a few minutes later, tell you the contract, etc. Then it's always, almost always, a 60-minute chart, because I just have come in my years, many years, 15 years, to see that that's like the true pulse of the ES market. Now, I do something that's a little dangerous, but I stick by it, is every single report I put in my last commentary, word for word, what did I tell you was likely to happen in the market? And there's a gray vertical line you can see in the chart. It's thin and it's there. You can bring your eye and say, okay, when Hima wrote yesterday's comment, that's where the market was. And so it's very easy to see how it played out, because I immediately follow with a recap of market activity, and I can't lie to you, a chart doesn't lie. So either it did something along the lines of what I said and that was helpful, or it didn't. Happens. But I think I have a pretty good batting average, which is why all those folks who are getting this for free from me were happy to pay for it once I said, hey, I want to make this my thing. Let's set up a subscription, and I'll give you some more stuff with the subscription, which you'll hear about in a minute. So we move on from the prior commentary recap to the outlook. This is obviously like the meat of the report. And it's not always this long, but it tells you what's happening on the day ahead. If there's timing windows, sometimes I get down to like an hour, or they're usually like a whole day session where I'm anticipating some key market action. Then after all this, you have the data, okay? Pure data, me with my eyeballs looking at the ES chart and giving you resistance and support, and they're relative to the current price action. And they kind of go in descending order, and they match what's on the chart. Now, something I added in actually just in August is trend line descriptions, because I use trend lines a lot, and my CMT teachers would come and slap my wrist because I don't use trend lines the way I was taught. I do a lot more things with them that don't fit the standard definition but work for me. So here, I use colors a lot, give you the anchor points for my trend lines so you can go draw them on your charts. So if you join the Skinny on the Mini Club, then obviously you would get this fresh analysis and the accurate levels. I actually have these live online monthly member sessions that started this summer, where I will get together with you for a whole hour every third Wednesday is what we're kind of aiming for, but may switch. And it's a pure hour of reviewing markets together, reviewing the ES. If you guys don't come to me with questions, then I teach you something new. Last week or 2 weeks ago, I taught my members details about my trend lines and other things to look for with them and my projections, etc. So this is a great, you know, time for us to get together on a regular basis. Those are archived and kept in a member portal. We are shifting, thanks to the help of TradeThirsty, I'm moving to a much more robust and awesome membership system. So these sessions are going to be archived in there. Now, obviously, to my members, I offer special discounts on future products and services, like courses I build, etc., things I was talking about. And you get priority email access to me and to my team. So I am at Hima@HimaReady.com, and my team is support@HimaReady.com. Okay. And here's a point I want to make about this RSI. So James K., who took a webinar just like you guys are here, said, to be honest with you, I've never been able to find a trading advantage using the RSI. So I was a little skeptical going into your introductory webinar. Wow, I'm ever glad to have attended. Since I now have the indicator, I've been looking at RSI power zone setups on Thinkorswim and been very pleasantly surprised. I see excellent setups on the NQ, ES, and CL intraday futures every day. Now, you're like, well, that's great, Hima, but all you told us about was the skinny. I want the indicator. Well, because of this Skinny on the Mini relaunch, we've got this special going where with your first month of the Skinny, you also get the RSI Power Zones indicator as a pure bonus. So if you look at this image here, this is a screenshot of where my indicators are housed, and this is what we have available. We've got TradeStation, Thinkorswim, NinjaTrader 8, NinjaTrader 7, eSignal, Ensign, Sierra Chart, and Trade Navigator. There are a couple more in the works, but these are the ones that are ready to go, okay? So let's look at all this together. The total value of my newsletter, when I look at the work I put into it and what I know other people could be charging for similar research, is $1,000 per month. And that's the value, okay, guys? That's the value of what you're getting. The actual indicator sells on its own for $97, but you're getting it as a pure bonus. But let's loop that value in with the live online monthly member session, which is a whole hour of my time for which I prepare before and wrap up after. So 1 month of this product and services from me comes to $15.97 in value. But let me ask you this. Even if that was the price, okay, that's the value. Let's say that was the price, but that I still helped you make an extra 10 ES trading points per week, which is $2,000 per month, then wouldn't that be worth it, right? You'd still net gain on the transaction. Well, I want to encourage you to get started soon and learn to expand your viewing of not just the RSI, but you look at price action. So we're not going to just keep it at 1500. We're not going to keep it at 750. Okay. The month-to-month price for my subscription is $97. The first month is $49. So first 30 days is $49, renews at $97. And you get the indicator. And you can get this at himareddy.com/power. Okay, like power zones. Now, I'll keep that link up there for anyone who's interested in checking it out. Again, $49 for the first month, renews at $97. Cancel anytime. The important factor to this, okay, like I said, this is a relaunch period. I want to keep your momentum going, and I want to see you act relatively quickly. So you've got till Wednesday, this Wednesday, October 4th at 8 a.m. Then I'm taking this off, and then you could still come and get the skinny, but no bonus indicator. So it's up to you as to when you purchase. But from this moment to Wednesday, October 4th at 8 a.m., you can get the bonus indicator. And again, you can cancel anytime. You just say, hey, whatever reason, I can't do this, email support at himareddy.com, and within a couple of business days, you'll be taken care of, okay? Now, why am I doing this? So my mission, my personal mission, and it's been this for years, even when I worked at investment bank and all their places, is to help as many traders as I can implement technical analysis and GAN's work in a way that improves their returns, frankly, whether it's cutting your losses, increasing your gains. And I want to do this by teaching through the skinny on the mini, where you take what you learn in the skinny and in our monthly sessions together and are able to apply to any market. So that's the thing, taking the skinny, using it to train traders to trade any market similarly. So I want you to remember this. I said I've been in this business for over 15 years, okay? If you don't change something today about how you approach your trading and investing, then think about where you're going to be at the end of this year or in 5 years or 10 years or 15 years. It's kind of freaky, but that's what it looks like, guys. That's time flying by, and it's up to you to take action with me, the other mentors today, and decide how you want to shape the course of your trading. So final details here. We've got to get ready for John to go next. HimaReady.com/power. Again, $49 up front, renews at 97, but you can cancel anytime. Skinny on the mini monthly subscription, so you get this to your inbox every day, but you also get access to an online portal to go download the indicator. And yes, I have instructions for most of these platforms. So you've got it for Thinkorswim. There's an instructional video I had created for that. You've got TradeStation. There's document instructions for that. And you can trade any market on any time frame with this indicator. I see a question here about, can you trade the SPY instead of the ES with the RSI? You can trade anything with the RSI as long as it's active, okay? You don't want to go to a market that's not very liquid or moving much. So active market, but any time frame. If you're a tick chart trader, that's fine, but don't take your RSI signals off the tick chart. Take your RSI signals off a 5-minute chart or a 15-minute chart or a 60-minute chart, whatever works for you. All right. So thank you guys. Appreciate it. Jeanette, maybe you can drop that link for me in the box. I don't know why I'm like still fumbling around with GoToWebinar, but himareddy.com/power. This is available until this Wednesday, 8 a.m. Eastern, because I generally publish the skinny around 8:30 a.m. I just want to like make sure all students are in class before we continue. Okay. So thanks again. And stick around for John Netto. I hope I'm saying that right. Thanks, guys.
You are saying it right. Thank you, okay. Hima. I did post a link in there. Hima, before you go, there's a question. Can they download the indicator if they have two different platforms? Can they download the same indicator on two different?
Yeah. Okay, yeah. So the way that this, guys, I'll show you this quick because we have a lot of indicator questions here. Excuse me. So please bear in mind, you know, these are human beings building this stuff out with me. And so all this is pretty brand new in terms of the portal and stuff. So I've got my support team to help you, but you go into your portal and you get your instructions after you sign up. Any one of these buttons, you can download all 8 or all 7 indicators if you want. You're paying for my RSI Power Zones indicator in whatever software I have it today. And as this updates and changes in the future, you'll have access to those too. Okay, that's like a lifetime access thing while you're a skinny member, because you're going to be logging in to get these items. So if you use TradeStation and Thinkorswim, then you can go download both. That's totally fine. There's not a limit. Okay, so great. Thank you for your questions. So there is instruction for Thinkorswim, guys. I just showed you a screenshot of the indicator buttons and the instructions. There's a video for Thinkorswim. I didn't want to put that on here because then you wouldn't be able to see the words of the others, okay? There is an instructional video for getting to Thinkorswim. It will walk you right through it, okay? So thanks again. Let me get going here. You can email support@himaready.com for administrative logistical issues. If you have analysis questions, hima@himaready.com. Thanks, and let's stick around for our last speaker.